Greetings. I'm here to do the a response to Arwen's tarot tag. What is it called? Hashtag tarot tag 15. Sorry. I really love this tag that she did. I don't always participate in the tags. Sometimes I do. I know they're fun. Most of them are really fun, but to be honest, some of the questions I really don't relate to. I think they're for, some of them are for people that are have a focus maybe in a different era than I do. But I really love this, the set of questions that she, Arwen, made up for this tag. They really resonated with me as a tarot reader. And I can't, I'm watching crazy everybody's responses. So I hope a lot more people respond. Anyway, she has 15 questions, and I will put a link to her original video down below so that if you want to respond, you can as well. But I think you're just supposed to use the tag, hashtag tarot tag 15, so she can find it, and also let her know if you're going to do it so she can go watch it. Anyway, there's 15 questions, and it's perfect timing for me because the first question is, what is your current favorite deck? And the reason this is perfect timing for me is, any other time, I would have very boringly said, my Hoi Polloi deck, which is here on my table. This is the deck I talk about ad nauseum. It is the deck, my original deck I've had since I was in college, probably. 1971, maybe. I think I got it. I'm not sure. Something like that. My very first deck, and I've had it in. It's a knockoff on a Rider Waite, but so the imagery is the same. Pretty much the same. Colors are different. Other than that, I've talked about that all the time. Anyway, my answer would have been that boring, because everybody knows the Rider Waite. I've just have absolutely fallen in love with a deck that I had had for quite a few years. I don't know how many years, but I don't know when it was first put out. But I've had it a long time, you know, several years, not a long time, but several years. I kind of liked it. I thought the images were kind of cool. But when I got it at home, I have to admit, when I got it home and looked at it, it sort of threw me. You know, sometimes I get thrown. I'm an old dog. It's not easy to teach me new tricks all the time. So I get home and I find a deck that has maybe some different cards, and you know, sometimes they throw off the order, or they throw off the, you know, they'll mix up the order of cards, or they have different names for this, for the, you know, the minor arcana, those kind of things. Sometimes it really throws me off, I have to admit, because I sort of read from habit. You know, we are so used to habit. And so I didn't really give this deck its proper due. Well, when I started reading professionally and started building up my website, I realized very quickly that not everyone likes the same deck. So you have to have a little variety. So I went back and revisited the Wildwood Tarot. And here's the book that comes with the deck. It has a lovely book that comes along with it. And I was just, the reason I said this was such a timely video, Arwen, is that I was just about ready to do a review of this deck as a video. I still might do it. But I was real excited to be able to talk about it anyway in your tag. So I'm going to say my current favorite deck is the Wildwood Tarot, with apologies to my Hoi Polloi deck. Okay. What tarot card, number two, what tarot card do you think stands for who you are now? Well, this is one of the reasons I love the deck, because I'm going to say right now I think I resonate the most with the Eight of Vessels, which is also called Rebirth. Now, this would correspond, of course, with the Eight, oh, is there a glare? Sorry about that. With the Eight of Cups, and I think everybody's familiar, I have one here in case you're not familiar with the Eight of Cups. And normally I would never say, this is what I like about this tag so much, this is that depending on what deck you use, I would completely choose different cards. I would never choose the Eight of Cups. I would never think that I resonated with the Eight of Cups, because for me, Eight of Cups sort of it has to do for me sometimes with regret or sadness. You know, the guy, he's walking away from whatever he had. It's time to move on. And maybe it wasn't, he's looking for a new beginning, but it's not necessarily a really upbeat card, right? Okay, well, that's okay. It's not necessarily a negative card either, but in the Wildwood Tarot, the Eight of Vessels is all about the rebirth. It's all about that. The emphasis is honoring the past and remembering the lessons that you've learned and using what you have learned to achieve your new goals. It's all about healing, a period of healing. And if you've been following me at all on YouTube, you know that we've been going through some real struggles in our personal lives, and we're all about trying to reinvent ourselves. And it's really difficult, I have to admit, at this point in my life. You know, I'm over 60 years old, and it's really difficult at that age for me and my husband to think about starting again at this age, starting again, reinventing ourselves at this age, and trying not to be resentful, trying not to think that what we have done in the past was maybe, you know, for nothing. Maybe we were following the wrong path. Maybe we have regrets. Well, this card is telling you no, there can be no regrets, and that's why I really resonate with this card. Okay, the next question is, what tarot card do you think stands for who you want to be? Well, again, I love this because if you were to ask me with this deck, with the Wildwood Tarot, I would say right now, I have actually two cards. One might be more long-term than, one might be more an immediate goal than the other might be more long-term. They sort of are related to my situation, so I'm going to use both of them. But for the beginning, I want to say the first card is the Ancestor. And there it is. There's a stag. It's a female figure standing in the woods. Stag head with the drum, that's the drum that I happen to play. And the little there's a meditation phrase that goes with this card, and it says, the ancestor is blessed by the land and by the divine knowledge that flows from the stars. This is all about trusting whatever is inside of you, right, and connecting to the past. And if you, again, follow my YouTube channel, you'll know that I'm all about connecting to the past. I'm a very big student of history, and I all the time say there's just not much new anymore in the world. You know, the lessons that were true in the past are still true today. And so I'm really into this card very much. And using the past, and the knowledge, not just my knowledge, but the knowledge of our ancestors to help guide us in the future endeavors, right? So that's very, very cool to me. And what I said was cool about this, the corresponding card to this in the Rider-Waite, my fan of, is the Hierophant. And to me, the Hierophant is, well, that's like the stuffy, you know, church card, right? It's all about established religion, established knowledge, but you know, traditional, not necessarily traditional knowledge, but you know, but knowledge, what do I want to say, institutionalized knowledge, to me. So I would not resonate with this Hierophant, want to be that. That's just not something I aspire to. This sounds very cool to me. This sounds like exactly who I'm thinking of. Okay, so that was sort of interesting. And then secondly, the other card that I really resonate with is the Six of Wands. I mean, the Six of Bows. In this deck, the wands are known as bows. And here we can see, I don't know if you can see it, it has to do with abundance. And there are the spears, the wands, the spears, the bows, actually the bows, laying around, representing the wheel. And here's the abundance, baskets of things down in the bottom. And I really like this card. I like this, and again, the corresponding cards in the Ho'oponopono deck would be the Six of Wands. And the Six of Wands has to do with, yes, recognition. You did a good job. You have succeeded. But it's also a lot about the recognition, being recognized for what you have done. And while most of us really resonate with that, that kind of the idea of being recognized for what you do, for me, this is really hitting me right now where I live, because I'm going to tell you, when you go through a period of time when you do not have things, you know, when you're really down, when you're really watching your money, when you really don't, like, we didn't have any income for a while, and we didn't, you know, I don't want to go on about that, but during that time, it's not so much, it goes beyond, your problem goes beyond just how am I going to pay my bills and how am I going to buy what I need, and etc. It goes beyond that to a feeling that you're really left out of things, and a feeling that you just can't help people that need help, and you can't share, you know, that whole, those whole things of sharing what you have with others. You become very miserly and become very, you know, holding on. You're holding on to your life, to the little bit that you do have. And that really changes your thinking. That really is very depressing. Okay, so this Six of Bows clearly speaks about the joy of sharing what you do have. And I'm going to be talking, this is also so timely for me, because I'm going to be talking a little bit in a video coming up about this. This is sort of my theme, as it were, for this year's Ostara. So I want you to stay tuned for that. But anyway, this was something that was really, really resonated with me. Those two cards, the Ancestor and the Six of Bows. Okay? Now we're going to draw a card. She asks at number 4, we draw a tarot card. I have my deck here. And tell how it answers the question, what does the universe want you to know right now? Okay. This is the thing I do not like about this card deck, is these cards are big. Ooh. And I lost one. Wait a minute. They're big and they're hard to shuffle. I know some of you are cringing when you hear me shuffling this way, but this is just the way I shuffle. I've done a lot of card playing in my days, and I really like to get a really clean, good shuffle on my cards. Okay. So anyway, we're looking for a card to answer the question, what does the universe want me to know right now? And we see. Okay. We see the 8 of Arrows. 8 of Arrows, which also called struggle, which would correspond to the 8 of Swords. It is the air card in the right of eight. It's called Arrows here in this deck. And I don't know if it's good or not. Since I have so much familiarity with the Rider-Waite images, I sometimes see that in my head and try to compare, and especially when I'm learning a new deck. And the 8 of Arrows, the 8 of Swords, I believe, is the image of the blindfolded woman. Isn't she standing in the middle of all those swords? And the idea is, I think that's the image. It looks maybe worse than it is, you know, like that. That's sort of my idea. Like she's scared to look, she's scared to turn around, she's scared to move. She's blindfolded, and because all these swords are there, she really doesn't know which way to go, and she's scared, but she's blindfolded. If she would take off her blindfold and look, she would see it's not so scary. There's a way for her to get out of there. But anyway, this card, a woman alone as well, in a struggle. You can see, I don't know if you can see, but she's really bundled up, and her clothes are very tattered. It's cold. There's snow on the ground, and the trees are bare, so it's obviously in the winter, very cold. She's obviously weathered a storm. The trees are bent. And there's also been a struggle of some kind, because we see broken arrows all over the ground where she's walking around her. She's treading through. So she's alone right now, but someone has been there in the past, and there has been a struggle. There's evidence of a struggle. Okay. Now this, just like the 8 of Swords, is a card I see that calls for courage. It's calling for, you know, looking inside yourself, getting your inner strength, And looking upon your wisdom again to do what you need to do. And I think this really is speaking to me. This is like a theme that's been speaking to me all along. I really like it though, because the imagery in this I like so much. She's not blindfolded, you know, like the woman in the Rider-Waite deck is blindfolded. She can't see what's around her. Here, this woman has a very strong, nice, sturdy staff in her hand as she walks. She's dressed well-equipped for the weather. Even though her clothes are kind of torn, she has nice, thick layers on. She's got sturdy boots. She's got leg wraps, heavy pants. Her head is wrapped. She's got fur around her collar. She's got the staff, I said, and she has a light. She has a light so she can see her way. So she's really not in as bad of condition as she thinks she is. And she's following the fact that there were arrows there on the ground. There has to be some other people around somewhere. And the fact that she's following water, water usually leads you to people. And when sooner or later, you're going to meet up with some people. So maybe she seems to be doing the right thing. She seems to be equipped for whatever it is she needs to be to withstand the struggle. So that's good news for me, because I hope to be equipped to withstand my struggle right now. Okay, so moving along. That was kind of interesting. Number five. Do you have any cards that you must love in order to work with the tarot deck? Well, I love Darwin's comment. Yes, she did. I think we all do. We have our favorite cards. For me, I'm very much into the imagery of the cards. I really don't care for cards that don't have images in the lower arcana. You know what I'm saying? That just have, like, here's a deck that I have that just has, this is the Tarot of Marseille, which, you know, here's the Nine of Cups. Like, what is that, you know? I don't like to read it. I really don't like to read it. And that was a gift somebody gave me as a gift, and I appreciate the gift. But it's just, I like to be able to take the querent in with me into the imagery and sort of explain why it is that I'm reading the card as I read it. So that doesn't really help when there's no images at all. But anyway, I do have a certain, I sound selfish when I say it, but I have five. I've got five cards that it really kind of matters to me. Now, it doesn't mean I won't read the deck. I won't use the deck if all five of these cards aren't good. But I've got some hang-ups, really more on five cards than on any of the others. The first one seems almost trivial, and it almost seems like I shouldn't even have to say it. Okay, and here we have it in my deck here. Here it's called the Moon on Water, but it's the Moon card. And if it's called the Moon card, you need to see the moon. The Moon card should have a moon on it. Okay. Some of these, here's one from the Goddess Tarot. Where's the moon? Does anybody see a moon in this card? It's called the Moon. The moon is way up here, cut off. You can only just see the very teeny bit of the moon at the very top. And no, I don't like that. I don't like that. Here's one from the, what is this, the Fairy Wicca. There's another gift that somebody gave me. Their friend was the artist on these, and I don't want to criticize their friend's art. I like the moon. At least the moon is on there. That's all I'm going to say. Not a lot of other imagery on there, but I just want to see. Am I being picky to say that I want to see the moon? I don't think I'm asking too much. Okay, so that's the first one. The next one would be, the Chariot. Okay, now the Chariot is one of those cards that sort of gets yanked around, and it gets, I don't know which one it gets mixed up with. Some decks, they change the order. I don't care about them changing the order so much. Because I really don't go by the number on the card. I go by the, what it's called. So the Chariot is the Chariot. I do like to see, I have to say, I really do like the traditional chariot. I like to see a chariot. It's called the Chariot. But I also like to see the lions. You don't always see those two lions, and I think they're very important to the reading of the card. I see a lot of a lot of meaning in those lions. And but interestingly, in this deck, number 7, instead of the chariot, it is called the archer. Totally different. And at first, my first reaction would be, well, I'm not too crazy about that, right? What? Where's the chariot? It's an archer. Well, when I was reading in the book, which again is a really cool book, it talks about the same kind of ideas, you know, the same kind of thoughts, the same kind of symbol, you know, meanings coming, you know, the importance. I really related to what I want to say because I do archery. I have done it. I shoot a longbow, and I recurve or a longbow in my medieval history group. I haven't done it in quite a few years, but I do know it takes a lot of strength, it takes a lot of power, and a lot of skill, a lot of practice. Just as a chariot takes a lot of skill. You know, you can't just go out and anybody jump on one of these puppies and expect it to work for you. You need to have skill, and there's so much force behind it. So there's a lot required of this. So a lot of the same kind of messages that comes from the chariot card are in here, and I really like that. I like when you take a little bit of a different, you know, rather than just calling it a chariot and having a bad chariot image, I would rather they do something like this, something true to the deck, and something completely different, but with the same ideas, with the same kind of messages. So I like that. Okay, the third one is the Hanged Man. Now, this is, again, it seems so trivial because the Hanged Man has a lot of meanings. It really doesn't have a lot to do with, I don't know, it's something of, I don't know how to say it. But one thing that's important to me in the Hanged Man, in the image, if it's going to show Hanged Man, I don't think the image should indicate that he is not there of his own free will. He's hanging there. He's, right, he's in the period of, he's sort of waiting, right? He's hanging out, seeing what's going to happen. Trying to make a decision, maybe. For whatever reason, it's a period of reflection, often. This picture, I think this was also from the Fairy Tarot. I don't know if you can see it. It's really small. But the emphasis on this card is there's a witch in the front. Well, it was a witch. It's not a witch. No, it's not a witch at all. Why would I even say that? It's just somebody wearing a cloak, a man wearing a cloak and a sword under a tree. The person who's hanging is way in the background, and it doesn't appear to be, he appears to have given up. He appears to be, like, hanging there, and his arms are flopping down like he's not even alive anymore. I don't even know if he's alive anymore. His eyes are closed. So, I don't like that so much, right? That sort of skews the meaning to me. Right? This guy is getting some insight from whatever he's doing hanging there. He's getting some kind of insight, as we see, by the sun behind his head, right? The light behind his head. So anyway, I really like that a lot. This one just doesn't speak to me that way at all, so I'm not sure. But another, again, in this deck, such a cool thing, instead of having a Hanged Man, in this one, they have the mirror. And they're using this image of all the ways to see things in the reflection of the moon, seeing reflection of the water, and again, also seeing reflection in the mirror. And this is ways, different ways of seeing things, you know, different possibilities, which I think is really cool for the Hangman card, or the replacement Hangman card. So this I really like too, okay? Now, the last two really quick. I seem to be talking too much, I'm sorry. Petty things. Tower. This is the image from the Rider-Waite, or from the Hoi Polloi in my case, the Hoi Polloi. And my little petty thing is I don't like to see what they're falling into. I like to think that maybe they're not going to be crashing into just rocks or cement underneath them, and maybe there's, like, you know, marshmallows. I don't know, underneath them. They're going to have pillows, some soft feathers, or big piles of hay, or whatever. You know, they're going to, you know, it's not going to be, they're not plummeting necessarily to their death. this is not a final bad thing. This is something that's really going to shake you up, and something big's happening here. And yes, there's going to be some loss, but it doesn't necessarily mean you're finished. And sometimes I just don't see that, because sometimes, like in this card, that same one, the Tarot of Marseille, here they are, and you see the ground. It's almost like they're hitting the ground. And I don't, that to me sort of bothers me. You don't have to say they're hitting the ground, but it just looks more like they're hitting the ground. And this one in the Very Tarot, it looks like he's going to jump off. He's just jumping off. And there's, that doesn't really read to me. That doesn't speak to me. Like what the tarot, how I read the Tower card. So it's almost like he's like a big show off. Like, ta-da, I'm going to jump off of here. Ta-da. You know, well, I don't like that so much. So I hope I'm not offending anybody by that. But one thing that's very cool, back again to my Wildwood Tarot, is they combine the Blasted Oak. The Blasted Oak is their It's almost reminiscent of the, it's almost a combination with the Hanged Man, as you can see, because it looks a lot like the Hanged Man, right? He's up there. But here, instead, he's kind of falling from the tree. We're not sure where how he's going to land, but is he falling from the tree, or has he been set free? Because you see this, you know, the lightning and whatever coming from his arms and legs, the fire. Like the things that were binding him to the tree have been broken by the lightning. We can see the lightning in the sky. Same as we see in the tarot card, the lightning. But instead of like the whole tree's not falling, he's falling from the tree. So that could be a lot of things. I really like that. So I like the combination, a little bit of the Hanged Man in with the tower in the, what it's called, Blasted Oak, in the Blasted Oak of the Wildwood Tarot. Okay. And finally, I think everybody looks for, in there, in the deck, we all look for the Death card. Excuse me. I need a little sip. Look away if it offends you, pardon me. Okay, excuse me. Death. We like to see it in different ways. This is a cool way. This is heralding, because it's a change, right? It's the end of something, beginning of something else. So we're heralding something new coming in. And stuff has died. Something is finished. Other things are beginning. And I really love to see this different imagery. It doesn't have to be the same. We don't have to see the skull. We don't have to see the horse or the flag or any of those things. Here's a really cool thing in my Wild Tarot. It's called The Journey. And there are my beautiful ravens, or crows, these are ravens, I believe, and the beautiful moon and the flight, something new coming from something that has died, giving energy to something that is new. And I really like the imagery here. There's a lot of decks that have really beautiful imagery for this card. Even this fairy deck, I don't mind, even though I have to be a little bit picky. It's called the Banshee. The Banshee Kaylee, what is the Kali, which is the Banshee crone, the old crone. But, you know, legend has it in Irish legend that the Banshee, the sound of the Banshee, when you heard the screaming of the Banshee, it meant somebody was dying. So it really did signify death. Not, I don't want to be picky, but you know, this doesn't signify death, so. But it's sort of, you know, it's a cool image. And there's the crazy banshee in the background. It wouldn't turn me off of the deck, but it wouldn't make me too excited. But this one turns me off. This is in the Goddess Tarot. And you cannot see anywhere. It's called Transformation. And first of all, the image is so hard to even see what the image means, right? That I just have a little bit of trouble with it. And I don't see how it, I just don't see it. I don't see it. I had to really work. I just did a reading with using this deck for somebody. I might take it out of I might take it off of my page because I'm just not real sold on the deck. Anyway, and even the Tarot de Marseille, you know, here's a really cool image. Just this very medieval image. I really like that one a lot. A lot different than the Wild Wood with the ravens. I mean, with the ravens and the moonlight, but still, it speaks to me just about the same. So I like that as well. So, anyway, those are my five. I don't mean to be selfish, but I don't have a lot of decks, so I can be a little more picky. Okay, number six. I'm sorry I'm taking too long. Number six. Why tarot and not some other divination system? Well, I said when I was trying to shuffle my cards, I do like to play. I've played cards in my life, like played cards, you know, card games, and I like Vegas and a blackjack, and I just like the feeling of cards in my hand. I love the imagery. I love to, you know, see the story, and as Armin says, see the story in the images. I really like to see that a lot. I have started to work with some other things. It's just something that I have done so long, and I think I'm good at. When you find something that you're good at, you why not do it? I'm experimenting with runes. I'm experimenting with, and I'm just now trying to get into tea leaves, reading tea leaves. I'm finding a little trouble getting good information on it because I think I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings, but I see a lot of people online on YouTube that are trying to teach people how to do read tea leaves that I'm not sure that they really know what they're doing. So I'm going to do some more research, but I love tea. So if I can do tarot because I love cards, I can do tea leaves because I love tea. I have a lot of tea. So why not try to read the leaves? Number seven, what's the first book you can remember reading about tarot other than The Little White Book? To be honest, when I was learning tarot, the more I read, the more confused I became, and it kept turning me off of it. To be honest, it kept turning me off of it, and I put the cards away and I get them out later. And I think it finally clicked. Something clicked in me after years of it, looking at it enough times, and really kind of avoiding the books for a while. Now that I read, I know there's some value in some books. I do have a few books. Really nothing that I would recommend, though. I just bought them because I thought I should have them. They don't really add anything to my experience. I'm sorry. I'm disappointed you in that one. I'm really sorry. When tarot person number eight would you like to sit down for... with Richard about tarot? Well, anyone here on YouTube, of course, that reads tarot, I would always welcome a chance to have a chat with you. I would love to compare styles with you or whatever. But if I could have anybody, I would say I would want to have a man called Charles Starr, who was my very first experience with tarot reading. It was in my hometown in Pennsylvania. I was in high school, or I think it was just the summer after I graduated from high school. I went with my friend. She was having her cards read, which I'm like, you were having your what? I don't know what she was talking about. We went to this man's house. She didn't even tell me whose house we were going to. When we got there, I nearly fell off my chair because he was somebody I knew from my church choir, very church, big church guy, right? Who read her cards, and I'm telling you, it blew us away. It blew us away. And that's when I fell in love with tarot. I just fell in love with it. And I've never seen him read since. I haven't seen him pretty much. I don't know if I've seen him much after that. I think he sang at my wedding. but other than that, I don't know anything about him or if he still reads. I hope he still reads, but I don't know if he does. But boy, he was really something, and I'd love a chance to talk to him and compare notes about tarot. Tell me about one YouTube tarot channel that you watch and why. Well, I'm embarrassed I don't watch too many just specific tarot channels. When people do an episode on tarot or something, I do watch it if it's what somebody watch normally. It's more of a question of time than anything else because I'm very interested and I'd love to hear. It doesn't mean that I'm not going to ever watch. I just, I don't seem to have enough time to watch the people I want to watch, so. And then I'm embarrassed about that, but I'm trying really hard to change that because I really love to share perspectives with other people. I just recently, within the last several years, I started reading Lynn Norman. Somebody did a little review on some of the Norman decks that they had. I forget who it was. Maybe Ember Honey Raven, I'm not sure. Several years ago. Or somebody. And it was the first I had heard of them, really. And I was fascinated by them. And I bought a few decks because I liked the imagery. And several years ago, I did we'll talk about that. I actually read with them. And so that's cool. And I did watch that person. There's a person I did watch for those. Her name is Donna Lee. Or Lay. Donna Lay. Donna Lay. L-E-I-G-H. And she's on a channel. Her channel is called Tarot Tribe Beyond Worlds. And that's how I learned to read Lynn Norman. I watched her videos, watched all of them, I kind of like them. I don't like them in the same way I like my tarot, but I do like them. Which I'll talk about in a minute. How many tarot decks do you have? Number 10. I have about 10 or 12 is all, a couple. That's including maybe 12, including my Lynn Norman decks. But I just don't, it's not that I don't really like decks. I like them, but I read what I read. I don't go out and buy unnecessary decks because, and most of the ones that I do have that are not, like the Wildwood I bought, and of course my Hoi Polloi and some other Rider-Waite I bought, but most of the other ones were given to me as gifts. Number 11, do you mix oracles and tarot when you read? I don't really read oracle decks, I don't think. I don't really think I do. I'm not sure if I even have an oracle deck. I might have one. I think I have one. Don't really read it. I was interested in what Arwen said, though, that she uses an oracle deck to ask a question and then she uses a tarot deck to answer the question. Oh, I might try that. That's kind of cool. Because number 11 says you mix them. And I do mix Lynn Norman and tarot. Oh, it's a sin. Oh, it's a crime. Oh, I did something bad. Well, no, I didn't. I did it as an experiment like about 2 years ago. I said, what would happen? I put them together. I have a special layout that I do using them. And I just did a special on it. And people liked it so much. And I like doing it so much that it's a regular, I offer it regularly. I offer it all the time as a regular reading. So I don't think it's necessary to put them together, but this was just a really cool way of putting them together, and I really liked it. Number 12, have you ever created your own tarot card or deck? No, I have not, but I'd really love to. That sounds fun. Do you read for yourself? Number 13, always. Nobody else, I don't think, ever reads for me. I'm trying to think of who has even read for me. Even Charles Darr did not read for me. I had maybe my cards read 2 times in my whole life. Does that sound right? Or maybe more, but I don't remember. I read my own cards. It's not that I'm opposed to it. I've just never had the opportunity for anybody to read for me. What I like to do with it is I don't do full, I'll do 3 card draws all the time. I like to do them. I like to read for myself when I am journaling. If I'm having an issue, I use it for dream interpretation sometimes. Especially when I'm needing a time to guide, what's going on around me kind of times. I do those all the time. And then I'll go for weeks and weeks and really not read for myself. So it's not something I do daily. I do it when I feel the need to do. Number 14, what are your favorite questions to be asked when you do reading for someone? This is really a tough one for me because when I started to read professionally for people, I realized I had to come up with some, a couple different readings, here's my relationship spread or here's my, whatever, kind of a, what kind of a thing? Because I don't really read yes or no questions, or like, it's really difficult for me. I like to read for people that know that I'm reading their energies, whatever the energies are around them. If they have particular questions, they're always free to ask, you know, those. That's why I do not do email readings. I only do in-person and Skype readings, or in-person. I do YouTube readings for people, but I have to get information about them first. And they're not my favorite, because I'd like to include the querent in wherever possible in the reading. Because it doesn't do me any good to go down a road that you don't want to go down. You know, there's something else that I can be seeing that you're really looking for. You know, because, you know, when you look at a card, it can be this or this. Well, if you really want it to be this, well, let's try and see if it can be that. We'll look and see what other evidence are that maybe that's the truth, right? I just did a reading not too long, very long ago, for somebody who was asking. I thought she was asking just for a general reading. And she apparently wanted something about her health. Well, I don't do health. I don't do health either. I'm not going to tell you if you're sick or dying or anything like that. I can give you general things about your health, but only if they come up in the reading. If they don't come up in the reading, I'm not going to make it up. It's there. It's not there. So I like people who just say, I like you to just tell me, you know, I'm sort of at a crossroads in my life right now, and I'm trying to make some decisions, and, you know, just in general, can you see anything that might help me make my decisions, or any people around, like, can I help me make decisions, or those kind of things. Those kind of questions are okay. But generally, I just like to just let me see what the cards are saying. Because the cards are saying what they're saying. I can't make them say anything different. And finally, number 15. Oh, I hope I didn't go too terribly long. I'm sorry again. What's the craziest thing that's happened to you during a reading? Well, it's just, I've even said it, I think, before. I have, you know, friends who, a lot of different kinds of friends. I have a friend who's a good friend who has, she's an evangelical Christian, very judgmental about tarot reading and divination, but she's very, you know, she's my friend, so she has accepted for what I do, and she's always been very kind about it and generous, and she was in a position when I was doing some readings for some people at a camping event. I always do readings there, and she was just in the vicinity because she shares my camp. And she was just around, and she couldn't help but to overhear, like, what I was saying in the readings. And she came to me and said, you know, I've been listening to you, and I thought, you know, you're doing, you know, I can see that what you're doing isn't really, it's not really divination. You know, that's okay. And I realize you say that, you know, the cards aren't really what the cards, they represent things, you know. Death isn't really I'm going to die or anything like that. So she said, I'd really like you to read my cards. So she sat down across me, and I shuffled the cards real well, and the very first card, you know what it was, I turned up, the very first card was the devil card. I swear to you, I think she fell over backwards. I think it was like I blew her, she's a small woman to begin with, just blew her, you know, right over backwards. She was so horrified at that devil card coming up. I just laughed. I couldn't stop laughing. I thought, oh my, that's just funny. Now she came back and realized it wasn't the devil, but it just, you know, the coincidence of that. Was it a coincidence? Just funny. Anyway, that's all. I'm sorry if this took too long. I talked too much, but it was really fun. Arwen, thank you so much for this tag. Oh, I like to do tags like this. I really like them when it's something I can really relate to, so. Again, I'll put the information down below so that you can do it too. And I'm looking forward to seeing everybody else's videos as well. So, okay. Thank you for coming and thank you for watching. I'm Rebecca. And as always, I wish you blessings.